The situation is grim.
344 cases to 8pm last night of community transmission. We have seen a surge in the number of cases and we expect that to continue.
But authorities think they've identified the weak link.
If people just applied the rules and they applied an element of common sense and a modicum of decency to the rest of the community, we would be fine.
Rest assured, we've thought and worked very hard to make sure people in those communities get every support they need so that people don't feel they've got to break the rules.
Here's what that support looks like. If you're living in a designated hotspot and you've lost hours due to restrictions, you can claim up to $750 a week through the COVID-19 disaster payment. And if you're a positive case or close contact, or you're the carer of a positive case or close contact under the age of 16, and you've been directed to isolate and you don't have access to leave entitlements, then you're eligible for the $750 a week federal pandemic leave disaster payment. But workers who don't clear those hurdles are landing between a rock and a hard place.
Some may wake up in the morning feeling a little drowsy or not quite right. They will then forego going straight to get tested. They'll fulfil the requirements of their shift to maintain their job and then probably go after the shift.
With some tests taking more than 48 hours to process, the hip pocket pain of testing and isolating is just too much for many.
A large number of them are contractors, they're casuals, and when there's a choice between putting food on the table for your family or not going to work, workers are going to choose to look after their families.
Still, the Premier's adamant that the support is sufficient.
We've always taken a very balanced approach in New South Wales so that people don't feel that they have to do anything or leave their home unless it's absolutely necessary.
Victoria's $450 COVID-19 test isolation payment covers anyone who loses income as a result of coming forward to test.
Access those payments. There's $450 if you can't go to work because you're waiting for a test result. There's $1,500 available to you if you've got to isolate because you've got the virus or you're a close contact. Those payments are there to be made.
Health experts have been calling for something similar in Sydney since last year. So as the outbreak continues to grow, can we afford not to cover the cost?
Professor Peter Collignon is an infectious diseases expert and he joins us now. Peter, what sort of impact could these payments make?
Well, what we do need is to look after essential workers and make sure if they get infected, because there are a lot of people who are transmitting it, they don't transmit it to others at the workplace and not to their own family. So any way we can actually help them get tested early and keep isolated is obviously an advantage. Now, the exact mechanism of doing that I'll leave to others who've got more economic and social expertise than I have. But everywhere, both in Australia last year, in Melbourne, internationally, essential workers who are often lower paid, they're people like cleaners, you know, grocery store workers, etc., they're often the most vulnerable, they have the most infection and transmit it the most. So we have to work out how best to support them so they get tested, they get looked after and minimise the spread to other people.
And so here are the real-world consequences of this, Peter. There's a moving opinion piece written in the Sydney Morning Herald. It was published yesterday by a doctor who's working in Western Sydney. And these are just the observations of what they are seeing at the moment. So I'll take you through some of that. Some patients are attending emergency departments. They are staunchly refusing to get tested because of the implications for their family. And I would presume they would be very often financial implications as well as familial ones. And then this, which was just sent a shiver down my spine, COVID-infected patients are presenting so late in the course of their infection that it's necessary that emergency teams intubate them immediately upon their arrival, which says to me they're not getting tested or something before, and so they're only turning up when it's really last ditch. And so this is potentially costing lives. Can you overcome something that's that tangled? Can you unscramble an egg like that?
Well, I think it's difficult to completely unscramble it, but I think we need to do better. And that actually means different communities need different approaches. I mean, there's different cultures. We need the people in those communities to be on side taking the lead to try and, you know, get everybody to understand this is important, you need to test, we need to be supportive of it, and we need to do it in a culturally sensitive way. Yes, we've got policing, but policing never works unless the vast majority of people agree with it. And so we need to get this message out better, I think, than we have, particularly to socially disadvantaged areas, because that's where most of the infections are. And there's a whole lot of factors that stop people both getting testing and even if they're sick, presenting when they should. So we've got to unravel those, and that requires not just scientists, that requires people with social knowledge, cultural knowledge, all of those things. And one size won't fit all. We need to be culturally sensitive and do what's best to work in those groups as best we can.
Peter, let's go briefly to the numbers. How long do you think New South Wales will be in lockdown for?
Well, I think there'll be restrictions for a while. I mean, these numbers aren't coming down. They're, in fact, slowly going up, which is not good. Now, on the bright side, there are areas where they have come down. The eastern suburbs, for instance, where this started, has come down. And even Fairfield, I gather, it's coming down there. But in the areas where it's harder to, if you like, get control because crowded housing, multi-generation people living in the same house, southwest Sydney, or a lot of it, that's still not coming down. So we're going to have to work out how to address that better. I mean, I know there's a lot of efforts, but obviously we need more people on side to be able to change behaviour in a way that everybody's on side. You know, you can't impose this on people. You've got to somehow get them better on side than they are now. So whichever mechanism that requires, we need to do better because this is not going to go away in a hurry. I think actually restrictions with time will come down as vaccination rates go up. But we're not going to be in a really good vaccination position till probably October, November. That's when we'll get 75, 80% of people fully vaccinated or a reasonable proportion vaccinated because we'll start to be able to do 2 million doses a week come September, October. But that's a long way off and we're going to have to work out how to keep the numbers down and minimise transmission as best we can till we get those vaccine numbers up.
Well, thanks so much for your insight, Peter. Appreciate it.
Thank you.
With so much content online, it's sometimes hard to keep up with it all. And let's face it, who has the time? The project YouTube has you covered with the stories that matter. Hit subscribe for a daily list of the news that you need to know.